The Kalahari?
There we go.
Sorry. That's close enough to seven. We'll get this meeting started. So I'd like to call the meeting to order. Start by introducing our board members, Kelly Kelcher, Ann Bauer, Kurt Karbuski, Linda Yu, Paul Kenny, myself, Bob Green, Superintendent George Ravolis, Annette Ashley, Sean Highland, Todd Smith, Assistant Superintendent Sherry Syra, and Deputy Business Services Lori Ames. And then obviously, welcome to our guests who were here before. It is much appreciated. This is a quick follow-up. The board will take the notes that were taken, and then we'll talk about and discuss some of the results that came out of this. So I want to thank everybody for participating in this. It was most helpful to the board. Every time we do this, we come away with a better understanding of what our situation is. And I just want to thank you for taking time out of your busy lives to come and talk with us. It is very much appreciated. At this particular point in time, looking for approval of minutes for regular minutes of October 10th, 2016. And let me see, so action, is that looking for a motion?
Second.
Hold. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Communications, citizen comments. Is there anybody here who'd like to address the board? Okay, correspondence, board communications. Before we go any further, we have one communication, which is probably one of the sweetest ones we've ever gotten. So Joanne Pauls has graciously given us some snacks for us to appreciate with. So we'll pass them one way and then pass them around the other way. And thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
Communications?
I went to park and also did the Glacier Creek tour, and then I thought we were meeting with them tonight, and I thought, how cool, because I was just out there, so I totally missed that somehow. We were meeting with tonight, but it was really cool to get out to both of the locations and check it out, and I look forward to the future ones too. So
I also checked out park.
Park and Glacier, I just wanted to add a little bit to that, say how the administrative staff were just so enthusiastic and so proud of their schools. It was great to see. The teachers and the pairs were very gracious with our presence, I thought, very tolerant of us being there and eager to explain things to us. And the student, the thing that really got me was the students. I can honestly say that every single student that I interacted with, and I was allowed free access in the classrooms, every single student down to the first and second graders was engaging, was polite, I just wanted to reiterate how important I think it is as a board that we continue to do this, try to make an effort to, might as well steal this, okay. Little distracted here. It's one thing to talk about what goes on in the classroom in an abstract way at the table here, but it's really another thing to get in the classroom and see what's going on, you know, the fly on the wall thing and really seeing it. So it's very helpful for me, and I look forward to the future visits. So
I'd like to request this to be an annual event because I broke my foot and cannot participate this time. I feel like I miss a lot.
We have several more visits planned, yeah. So your foot will heal, correct?
I'm getting there. Okay. I'm getting there.
That's what we're counting on. But yeah, we'll do this every year, absolutely.
Well, we have like,
I think about four or five more.
I also visited both schools, and I want to echo everything that's been said so far and say thank you to the administrators and teachers that welcomed us and talked about what goes on in the schools on a day-to-day basis.
I was not able to make that particular event because of a work conflict, but I've done those kinds of tours. It is very helpful to check to watch what's happening and interact with teachers and just see firsthand what's taking place on the school. So definitely a great idea to continue throughout the year like it's scheduled.
I attended a day and a half seminar up in the Kalahari, put on by WASB concerning legal issues, and I found it to be extremely informative. A lot of great takeaways, and the information that was provided in the seminars that I did participate also had a lot of resources that linked to external sites to continue the learning process. So I'm very excited about where we're going, understanding a little bit more of the challenges that we're facing, and really, feel good about where we stand as a district, considering a lot of the school districts and the challenges that they're facing and the resources that they have to try to tackle those challenges.
I participated in the school visit as well, and I thought, just echoed everything Kurt Wood said. It's really insightful to be able to just wander the school, step into any classroom that you want to. Teacher knew why we were there, and we're very accommodating and welcoming, sometimes explaining what was going on when they could, and other times just happy to have us in and remain focused on their kids. Kids were great too. I mean, they're just incredible. And I had more than one come up to me and said, "You school board member?" Yes, I am. And then you know, he asked me a question, then would scoot down the hall. So the kids clearly knew we were coming too, which is great, which is fine. So thanks to everybody who made that happen, and looking forward to more visits.
If I could, a little bit of housekeeping here. On December 12th, we have scheduled another roundtable, but Annette was nice enough to bring to my attention. Typically, what we've done in the past is whenever there's been band concerts coming up, we do our best to allow, you know, because we also understand that board members are also parents as well. So we try to work around as much as we can, and that there is a scheduling conflict in that. So I know George and I just briefly talked about that and see what we can do about making some alternate arrangements, because it's important that not only your obligation as a board member is satisfied, but also your obligation as a parent in band concert. Take a look at that, and then we'll see what we can do.
I talked to Cheryl, and what we'll do is we'll communicate with those principals to reschedule the listening session from December 12th to a later board date.
And then perhaps if we could just maybe check on another concert so we don't do it, accidentally reschedule at another bad time. So thank you, Annette, for that as well. Any other correspondence or board communication that we need to bring up at this time? Okay, superintendent's report, George.
All right. I had put on the weekly bulletin that we will need a couple board members to serve on the Certified Staff Handbook Committee. We're going to start meeting in January. That'll probably take January, February, March. We're looking at about a three-month window. So I'm just kind of looking to see, are there any board members that are interested? Bob, Ann, and Todd. Excellent. So we'll go. Anybody else? Just want to make sure. Okay, those three will be on the committee. Thank you. That's going to quick write them down. Also, just a couple little things. Several of us are meeting with some educators from Australia tomorrow. They're here looking at sustainable schools, and heard about our district, and we're doing some tours, and then we're going to meet with them at the end of the day. So we're looking forward to that. Tabitha, Lori, and I are meeting with Al Yeager. He's our insurance consultant tomorrow, just to start looking down the road. However, we are under our rate cap again for next year, so we're in really good shape. But we want to start ahead for the 18-19 school year, just to start that dialogue. I will be going to Upham Woods Wednesday with Steve Soderbergh in the morning, where it's 100% chance of rain with a high of 46. I checked, but we are actually teaching two sessions because they were short on instructors, and so we didn't check the weather before we said yes, but we are looking forward to that. So I don't know if any of you have children up this week to Upham Woods, so we will be up there. And then finally, I sent the links to our forward exam and ACT results in the Friday weekly bulletin. But as you saw, again, our students were top performers in the county. Couldn't be more pleased with their performance and the performance of our faculty that just do an incredible job every day. So we're really proud of that as well.
Yeah, I'd like to echo that as well. I actually had some people at my place of work who had read that and looked at that and wanted to know why our test scores were, say, so much different from other schools inside the Big Eight. So, again, congratulations to everybody in our school district, because it's just not one individual's actions, it's a group of actions that allowed us to get to where we're at here. So, again, I want to express my appreciation as well as the board's appreciation to everybody's work and effort that allowed us to have such good results. So thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. That's all I have.
Okay. All right. We're going to move into consent agenda. I offer up for consent administrative services approval of bills payable. 5A, 5B, approval employee services approval of resignation. There's also an addendum at your desk as well. Approval of leave of absence and approval of staff appointments.
All moved.
Second.
Go ahead.
Participate in the consideration of the Godfrey and Kahn invoices.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Passes. Thank you very much. Neil. What did we get you up quick? Neil has a class to teach, so we were hoping to.
I'm afraid of what could happen when I'm gone at the high school. So.
I'm here to report tonight on the progress we're making with our energy program. And I have two really good files to use to document that will explain what we've been doing. I just started my 13th year, and composition of this board sort of changed, but I'm getting new people. I appreciate all you're doing and the support you've given me, especially the administration. We're doing really well at the district.
We have in front of
okay,
us.
Okay. If you have the one that's the graphic of the with the pie. But you can get an idea of what we're doing right now. We're at $3,310,000 approximately for our cost avoidance. Thank you. That'd be great. Appreciate it. Next time we'll bring mine. So what you have here on the top is the expected cost over 13 years, which would have been $14,896,000 and change. And we actually spent $11,586,000 approximately. So our overall savings, which we call cost avoidance, it's a difference between what you would have spent and what you actually spent. So we're at $3,309,000, and it's overall it's 22, almost 23%. For the district, which is outstanding. Let's see.
There we go.
And the next item on there is the progress, that line, the blue line from September 2004, that was the beginning of our program. And this is the cumulative energy savings over 12 years to September of 2016. And this is the energy savings. MMBTU is an astronomical figure. I can't even explain it. One BTU is the amount of energy it takes to change 2 feet of water, one degree. So it's a huge amount of energy that we didn't use. Okay, so the energy impact was 150,306 MMBTU, a number I can't even explain. The equivalent of 18,846 metric tons of CO2. That's what we've avoided using. It's a huge number. And it equates to 3,926 or 27 passenger cars for 1 year being off the road, or about 500,000 seedlings. All right. So we've done a great job over the years. So this is our 13th year. Currently, we did our measurement of the Energy Star scores in the school district, and we visited.
There were two groups. We visited all 10 educational buildings, and
pleased to say that all of our buildings are over 90%, 97, 91, 99 rating. If you have a 75 rating, you get the Energy Star Award, so we're way ahead. And I have to report that Sauk Trail, one of our oldest schools, is at 99 rating, outstanding. That is just outstanding. Todd Duquette, who is the head custodian, does a marvelous job with the equipment. All of our schools are doing well. We're one of the few districts, I think we're only one of two in the state that has all of the buildings over 90. So, and that's a tribute to and a reflection of the work being done by the whole staff, the teachers, the general staff, especially the maintenance, and we have maintenance people led by Bill Everhart, and custodians who do a marvelous job because they're all in control of their own buildings now. So we're doing great things, and we should get the Energy Star Award for each school, which would be outstanding. And the other video I'll just pass, I think I can remember it, is, or the other report, the other document, is the report on Cromery School. Mm-hmm. We did a database after construction, September 2014 through August 2015. So we had to enter all the utility bills, and then we measure against that. So this year is our first measurement year, and I mean, they're doing gangbusters. I think they're at 55% cost avoidance. That's unheard of. Now, the reason is we had inflated numbers for the first year. We weren't sure what was going on with the school with all the new technology, and the numbers were very high, and we were very concerned. So we entered into an agreement with, or a work practice with MG&E, and on focus on energy. It's called On Demand, and the whole program has been designed to reduce our electric demand. And if you think of an accelerator, that's your rate of demand. So if you push on the gas, you use more. We've dropped from, I don't know what our demand was. At one point last winter, it was 948 kilowatts per day. That was huge. Very scary. We've already dropped that down to under 200. That is the program that's been going on. We've done that at the high school. We've also done it at Elm Lawn. And what we've done is we've taken the practices of the head custodian. They've managed to tweak things in the school, not turning on the, or bringing in fresh air in the morning, preheating, that sort of thing. So they've just tweaked all the equipment. They've got this demand down. Our electrical charges are down. I think we saved $27,000. So it's a lot of money we've saved. So we're doing really well. Hope to do it at the other schools. So that's whether or not focus on energy actually renews the program. I'm not sure if that. Bill Everhart has been working on that. And, we're getting great numbers. So I'm really pleased with what we're doing this year. And I'm trying to think of what else we can be. Oh, I'm going to be at the, I'll be giving a tour tomorrow with, for the Australian individuals. I'm going to tour them around the high school, show them some of the techniques we've used and some of the new technology. Excuse me, the PAC. And then on Friday, I'm going to be part of a panel discussion over at Cromery, and that'll be exciting too. So I'm going to use the same files to explain what we're doing. But overall, the program's doing really well, and again, we're at $3,310,000, which I think is pretty outstanding. And I thank all the people involved in doing it. Staff has done a marvelous job.
Any questions?
Best about the first 4 years we were under contract with, it was called Energy Ed at that time, now it's called Synergistic. They were our consulting firm. We had to raise, or we had to save $100,000 a year to break even. If we didn't, then they would pay us back. So it was a win-win for us, but you can look at the figures starting with September, how it grew. Our first year we only had $100,000, and they made it work, so they didn't have to pay us the money. But we paid about $100,000 a year for the first 4 years. After that, it was all profit for us. So it's just my salary, and I've gone from 20 or half-time down to quarter-time. So hopefully that'll help, too. So it's basically, now I can walk into a building, and I know right away if it's performing well, it's quiet, it's dark. And then most of our buildings are, you walk through, and you don't have to go to every room as I did in the early days. So everybody's doing a marvelous job. Sure.
First of all, I just want to commend you on the work that you've provided, as well as the staff that have worked to achieve these goals. It's my understanding that with the Energy Star rating, getting a 90 and above is magnificent in itself, but maintaining that is a real challenge, because not only are you trying to stay in that top 10%, but all the other schools to try to reduce their expenses are trying to become more efficient. So maintaining that top 10% is that much more of a challenge.
Yeah, it's a challenge for the school, but what we've done is we've really, we've changed over quite a bit of the staff in terms of the head custodian positions. We've got some guys that are crackerjacks now at handling their schools. They really study it, and they're really into fine-tuning their buildings. They can balance the school fairly well. We still get complaints, you know, it's too cold, it's too hot in certain rooms, but overall our schools are more comfortable. And the whole program is supposed to be for comfort during the day. Standards, student and staff should be comfortable. After, say, 4 o'clock in the afternoon, then we start ramping down. And that's where we supposedly save our money, after hours. So yes, it is difficult to maintain that, but I'm confident our staff can do it.
Going forward, would there be an opportunity to maybe include a graph and show how the EUI or energy utilization or energy use intensity has changed over time, or the KBTU per square foot, how that's changed over time?
I can run those
because
reports
that's
and send them
a nice
to you.
Measurement that shows what is the actual energy reduction.
Right. I've got a ton of reports, and this is a basic report we use for semi-annual report for board meetings. So that comes
be
from
very
our consultants, but I can run a whole slew of reports, and that's one of them we can pull up and share if you'd like to see that. One of the reports I look at is cost per square foot or use per square foot at each school, and then we get a range of, you know, all 10 buildings. So somewhere in the middle, anything under that, the schools are doing marvelously, but the other ones might be lagging a little for different reasons. They're all different buildings. They all have different technology and different approaches, different practices. But if they're over the average, then we look at that and say, well, what can we do with these buildings to bring that square foot cost down? So hopefully we can do that. But even our high school, which they're always in a mid-range, which is good because they're a big building and they use a lot of energy. So we have to maintain, we have to get to that point where we can say the high school is at a certain, you know, dollar per square foot or use per square foot. And hopefully that's right in the middle. If we can get it lower,
but it's like a
city, it's open all the time. So
questions? As stewards of the taxpayer dollar, programs like this, I think, are extremely important, because I think it's beneficial to all the taxpayers and also people who vote as well, that they want to know, are we taking care of their money? Are we handling their money in an efficient manner? And this is just one piece of that puzzle, but it's a very important piece, which is important to not only, you know, to many people inside our district. So your work is not only appreciated here at board level, because the amount of money that we're not spending on energy, we can spend on teachers, spend on education, but also shows the other people who don't have kids in our school district that we are doing the best we can with the money we have. So I just want to thank you for helping us to do better.
I would like to thank you all for your support. It's been a real boon for me, and I'm really excited about the start. From the get-go, we've really pushed for it. We have a staff that's really engaged now. My job actually is a cultural part of it, changing the culture, you know, getting people to turn off their, if they go to a meeting, turn off your room. You know, and a lot of our teachers now, especially elementary, will run their rooms instead of four banks, they'll run it at two. And that's, you know, it's been worthwhile for them. You say the kids calm down, it seems to assist them in learning. So whatever the staff can do to minimize our use of energy, that's what we're after. And Bill Eberhardt and the facilities group, they've done a marvelous job changing over the technology. We have high bay lights now. We used to have 72 metal halide lamps in the field house, and each one of those were burning 24/7. They were 460 watts apiece. Well, we've cut that by two-thirds at least, and there's new technology coming out now. There's a lamp that's a T8 lamp like these, but it has a vent in it, and it's must be an LED, and we're testing those to see. Obviously, we can't change them all over, but over time, as bulbs burn out, we'll be changing over to new technology and reducing our wattage. That's the hope. So
you identify right there, it's a change in culture, not so much as a change in technology. And anytime you try to make a cultural shift, it's a much longer, slower process. And obviously, you've
took us a while.
It took you a while. So again, I want to thank you for that and your continued efforts.
I just want to point out, Neil mentioned the roundtable that he's on. We are hosting the Green and Healthy Schools Institute on Friday at Cromery Middle School. And I just pulled up the schedule in case anyone is interested. It's from 9 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. And there are keynote speakers. There are breakout sessions. There's a tour of the building. Lori has a small part. I have a small part. And then the roundtable sharing. So
I'll be using these too.
So what I'll do is I'll forward this to the board, and if anybody wants to, we would welcome anyone coming.
And at any time, if you want more information, don't hesitate to call, because I've got a billion reports I can run. I don't even know what I have. I mean, there's so many. There are lists and lists of reports I can generate, and I can give you more information. So if you ever have a need, just email me or call.
Thanks, Neil.
Great work.
Hey, school improvement team reports. Carrie, I think you drew the short straw and you get to go first.
So I am here tonight with three of the 4K teachers. The start of the school year has been phenomenal. One of the smoothest starts to a school year, I'd say, in the 4K history. So that's good to report. We have right now 324 students. We have 9 different sites. 8 of those are community partners. So I have Joelle and Pauls, who is at Elm Lawn, which is our integrated 4K classroom. And then Myra Stoikes, who works at Little Red. And Vicki Farnsworth, who is at Middleton Preschool. And they're here tonight to just share what's going on in their classroom, talk about some of the highlights and some of the new things that we have going on this year. I'll turn it over.
So this year we partnered with Pleasant Branch Conservancy, writing an outdoor curriculum to really connect the kids in school to the outside. We didn't have really anything like that. We do like outside time, but nothing to really connect them with nature. So over the summer I worked on a curriculum with another 4K teacher, Emily, and we wrote an outdoor curriculum. So they're just 10 little units that get kids connected with nature, really spending out some time outside. So the curriculum is called Adopt a Tree. So in my classroom, we broke up into groups, and then we were kind of assigned trees in our area. And it kind of looks different for every classroom, depending on class size and trees that are available. And they got to name their tree, which is always fun, having a four-year-old name something. So we got some fun names. I think that was my favorite part. But we put together kits that the Pheasant Branch Conservancy had a grant that they from a donation, a woman there donated. And we put together these kits that the teachers are able to check out. They come with books that kind of go with what we're talking about in that individual lesson. just ideas, any tools, magnifying glasses, tweezers, stuff like that. But all in all, they're pretty easy. They connect to what we're already doing in school as far as math and literacy. Lots of parent outreach things. Every lesson has a parent outreach component. And then at the end, we're hoping to kind of wrap everything up with a celebration at the Conservancy, so families can go out there and really see the Conservancy and kind of have a big family outreach celebration. So so we all got binders and all these books, and I've learned lots about trees myself. We found out kind of what trees we actually have in our space, which is kind of fun. And we're using the iPads to take pictures and look at the growing, the changes in the trees. So, yeah, that's been really fun, I think. Yeah,
it's been well received by the teachers.
Yeah.
It does look different in each site, so.
And our tree names are Shark and Sparky. If you were curious about what a Florida would name a tree, yes.
I have Mickey Mouse, Crystal, and Rainbow, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're fun.
Leafy.
Yes,
very literal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else you want to share?
I don't think so. The lessons are really flexible. We didn't want to have to bind teachers in doing, okay, now it's October, we got to talk about this. Now it's November, we need to talk about this. Now it's spring, we're going to talk about the budding of the trees. So there are 3 lessons out of the 10 that need to be done kind of in order, just like an introduction and then like a wrap-up. But everything else is very flexible for the teachers to kind of use it on where they are in their teaching at different levels and stuff. So yeah, that was nice.
We're always looking for different ways to connect our schools and communities, and this is a big way at the 4K level that we can do that. This is already happening at the elementary, middle school, and high school level, so it's another way to include 4K.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a great way, too, to integrate families, too, mm-hmm. to get them out, because if the children are talking about an activity that they did, they can, you know, extend that at home or on the weekend. We do family outreach calendars, so it's something we can integrate with that also.
Yes.
Do you want to talk about our social emotional focus and all about mindfulness and yoga that you've been talking about? So I have been doing yoga for a while, so I'm glad that the district is starting on board with that terrain. I think that similar to what the GM did with a curriculum that's easily integrated into a very short 4K day, Carrie kind of touched on the second step curriculum that 4K now has at each site in each classroom. And it's something that not only provides cohesiveness across all 4K sites, I think it also allows for us to integrate some pretty basic social emotional skills into every part of our day. Mm-hmm. Recess, snack, morning meeting, lining up to go outside, times that maybe we don't always think about as learning time, because we get caught up in the moment, so it's nice to have something to kind of check us. I think it's also been good at our site for the other adults that the children are interacting with, support staff in the preschool or professional development that happens at the preschool can actually come up and become part of the culture of the preschool. As far as the children are concerned, I think it's been phenomenal. I mean, I've always prided myself on the community that I build in my classroom, but it's really fun to see the children engaging with each other, with themselves when it comes to what does it mean to be sad or what does it mean to be angry. And now they have the capacity and kind of this similar touchstone to go back to. I think that's been really good for everyone. And then tying into that, the mindfulness, just that idea of slowing down and being mindful of who you are. Because I think in general, 4K and early childhood believe that we are raising human beings. And so I think it's really important that we take that time to help them understand who they are. And I think that between second step, kind of focus on mindfulness and breathing, and where are you, who are you, is so important. And so I'm really glad that, again, across the board, we're all being included in that type of conversation. So I think the two things are so connected and very near and dear to me. So I think that everyone
I think there are topics in the second step. I piloted last year, so this is my second year on it. And it's, the need is different every year, but the topics in the second step, there are things that you don't always think to teach that sometimes come naturally to some kids or some parents talk about, but some kids don't know how to communicate their needs, and this is really breaking it down to make it simple and easy for them. And I've been really using a lot of the children's books that they have a website that links you up with different children's books that go with the lessons, and just like we read the little engine that could, this little engine is using self-talk to really keep them going, and you guys can do the same thing too, and it just ties it all together so nicely, I think, so.
And I just want to say I'm really pleased that you were two of our community staff members. I think the collaboration that you're able to continue on with and that we have achieved together as a group says a lot about a program that could potentially be disconnected because of the locations where our community sites are and our ability to find time to meet together and to collaborate. But I really feel like every single teacher that is a core teacher from the Cross Plains School District definitely takes pride in what they're doing for our district and for our children. And they take a big part in making sure we have the programs, making sure that we're implemented and that training is provided. So that's a really important piece that I appreciate from our program. I just want to have a few of you all know that the school-based program is national and online. And I do want to say that, of course, the move and the timing and the reasons behind it, there's challenges to any type of major move from building to building. But I want to say how pleased both Bob and I were with all the support and help we received from the people from administration, especially online. Bob Shell has gone out of his way to make us feel a part of the school and make sure that we have what we need to be successful there. The custodians were phenomenal. At the beginning of the year, I don't know how to get everything done that we need to get done, but then to add us to that piece. And we have pictures that I should probably share of the boxes that we have set from us knows. And then I went to open the wall. There's a lot of stuff coming in. No, there was a lot of stuff that he has led, and he took it in his stride, where you have a hallway filled with boxes that need to be unpacked in a week. And they still needed to do some carpet in that hallway. They still needed to finish up our bathrooms. But whatever we needed, they were there. So any little things that, you know, we're still working on cleaning up, we're still working through, are minor compared to those big things that you helped us address and make sure that we have what we need. So we really do appreciate that. It made things go much smoother to the beginning of our year. A piece I want to share, especially for some of the new board members about the school-based program, is there's a purpose. Well, several purposes, but one of the main purposes in having a school-based program is we're considered to be an integrated site. So we co-teach. My role is special ed, and Barb's role is the 4K curricular ed teacher. You wouldn't know that coming to our classroom, and that's the way we want things to look in our classroom, but there's a real big reason behind that. We wanted a place where we knew that all of our friends could be successful. Prior to being part of the 4K classroom, I was an early childhood special education teacher, and I was a classroom teacher. Typically, if you're an early childhood student and you're in a classroom setting, you've got some pretty significant needs that can't necessarily be met in the community. So we knew we needed a place for our friends to be successful if we wanted to implement a 4K program. There are a lot of things that were put in place that really make our program successful, but I think the biggest thing that comes out of it that maybe you don't think of when planning something like this is the relationships that the children are developing with each other and the understanding of differences and needs and being supportive and it becoming a norm. These are the friends in my classroom, not, oh, well, in this room there's these friends, in this room there's these friends, or at home or in my neighborhood I have these friends, or at school I have different friends. So that's been, I think, something we've celebrated.
Absolutely.
Being there
last week was powerful to see the kids who had, you know, left the three-year-old classroom, and now they're in a program with their peers. Incredible relationships, and it's, you know, beginning of the school year, so we have a lot to be proud of.
Yes.
And yeah, just, you know, thank you for all your support. Definitely, we're open to taking board members on tours of the different 4K sites. Just call our email, and you can set that up. Yeah.
Thank you.
We're just going to be highlights.
Okay. Start from this side. I always start on this side. Start over here, Todd. Nope. John? Nope.
Thank you for coming and talking about all the stuff. That sounds great. I just wanted to, just out of curiosity, could you explain to me, like, more specifically what the parental integration looks like? Or you're talking about projects on the weekends, or what does that look like exactly?
As far as the outdoor curriculum, they're just things to do at home. They don't cost money. They're things that are easy to do at home. This is like find a tree outside your home or a nearby park and notice some of the sights and sounds and smells. So this is kind of a lesson about the five senses in a tree. So you're listening, you're looking. And that's kind of doing the same thing at home with a family member and noticing how they're different at school or at home, similarities and differences. So it's easy things like that just to get parents involved, even just a quick 15 minutes a day, you know, focus that attention. Same with our calendars. We send out a monthly calendar, and on each day it's different things that they can do around the house. Help wash dishes with your child, or find something around your house that starts with the letter M, or play, you know, set up pillows and play leapfrog on the pillow, stuff like that. So just to kind of get them connected.
And there's a parent outreach component to a program for that program. That's a requirement. So not only is it what we can do,
I just wanted to mention this from a PTA standpoint that just came into my head because I was just at a meeting for Winter Carnival, and we were interested in doing outreach to the 4K kids that will be going to Sunset Ridge to introduce them to that event and invite them to come and be a part of that. So that'll be something that we need to discuss further. But also, I encourage anyone to do the community sites visits and tour Joe Allen's room. They are so fun and funny, and they make me laugh every time that I go. So.
Big kids.
No, sometimes you do. But yeah, I encourage everybody to do that and sign me up because I'd like to do that. I know it's kind of hard in September because they're just still kind of in the. So.
Nothing. No, thank you.
Again, thank you. Obviously, 4K is important, and also before that as well. Not only for equity, but also just some families struggle, other families succeed. I think I mentioned one of the groups, the inability to access some what some families consider basic flashcards, books such as that. And for kids to come into school already being behind and they just started school, just certainly doesn't help. So the program that you're working on is obviously just as important as any other program that we have. And for some families, probably even more so important. So thank you for what you're doing, because every child's important. Every child has different needs. And the more needs that we can meet and help with, it ensures that every child has an equal chance of succeeding. So thank you for at least getting them an early start. It is really appreciated.
Yeah, thank you so much for being here, all you do.
Thanks for
having
us. Okay. I was going to say they'll flip a coin and figure it out, or they'll come up together.
Yeah, looks like together.
Yep.
Yay.
I just get Ross and I.
We like collaboration. Yeah.
and he's harassing me because I have my handout, and that's only because I have the AGR data that I need to share to be in compliance with.
Okay, so he's going to let me go first. Good evening, everybody, and especially to those of you who I wasn't in the small group with. If you remember from the spring, I'm the one who gets to come talk to you twice a year because of the AGR. With that, for the fall, I have put the different assessments. The first table is the literacy assessments that we do kindergarten through fourth grade. The second table is are the math assessments, and I'll explain those a little bit. And then in the fall, I look at where are students that qualify for free and reduced lunch, the percentage that were advanced or proficient on that assessment. And then just as a comparison, I put what it is for non-free and reduced. The emphasis isn't necessarily on the gap. The goal's been written that we're trying to increase the number of students with free and reduced status in the proficient advanced range by 10%, by 10 percentage points from fall till spring. But I just wanted to put that comparison so you could see where the rest of our population is. So literacy, we use the PALS, which is the phonological awareness literacy screening, the state-wide benchmark assessment. And I'm not going to read over those numbers. You can read those, but just to see where that is at. First through fourth grade, we use the benchmark assessment system, which is the Fountas and Pinnell running record, and to see where we fall there. With the kindergarten math, the comprehensive growth assessment is a portion, is part of the Bridges curriculum that we are using. And I just made the note, the counting and cardinality portion, we changed this year what portions of that assessment is rather lengthy assessment, and across the district changed what parts we gave. So we took the part that felt like would be representative of the growth throughout that area through the year. One interesting part, the structuring, was an assessment that we've used for a number of years. And in comparison to last year, our percentage was about the same for our students receiving free and reduced lunch. And the percentage was much lower for our students not receiving free and reduced lunch. And this year, it more than doubled. And one reason that we started the Bridges curriculum was because it really promoted the higher level thinking. And I'll be interested to see if this carries on each year, but what that told me is our students not receiving free and reduced lunch were really accessing that curriculum and really able to learn from that. But for some reason, our students receiving free and reduced lunch just weren't growing like our other students were. So something that we'll definitely keep an eye on and see how we can bridge. And then we use the measures of academic progress, the math map assessment for second through fourth grade. Questions on this? And again, I'll report back in the spring looking at our students receiving free and reduced lunches, how they've improved.
So I don't recall clearly before, when you shared the data, do we have the longitudinal data, you know, keep tracking students from K to fourth grade over time to see
We have, I would have from last year.
Mm-hmm. And I can look longitudinally.
Mm-hmm. And would pull kids that are here both years, mm-hmm. you know, because even at the end of the year, we pull out the kids that move in and move out. Mm-hmm. So that would be something that I can start tracking as I've been pulling for the achievement gap, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And,
yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's definitely something we'll look at. Because we want to make sure if we were able to bump some kids from developing to proficient last year, we want to make sure they're staying there and not falling back. Yeah, so we will continue to look at that. Thank you. So the flip side of that was just a way I could talk for much more than 10 minutes on things that are going on in the school regarding our district goals and school goals, and just wanted to put a visual to what we're talking about. So decided to use a visual of the iceberg. And looking at those pieces above the iceberg as being the actions, and below the water, part of the iceberg, the values and beliefs. And I would say we've really, this year especially, last year, and as we've done more work with equity, really spent more time in the values and beliefs. And find that we really need to build that why. Why are we doing the things we're doing? And deepen that understanding. So we've been doing that, really looking at family engagement. And what does family engagement mean? It's a term that we throw around a lot. And have spent a considerable amount of time not thinking about the actions, not thinking about the above the iceberg, because we've done things before, but not really thinking about the whys of it. So backing up a little bit, with student engagement, we did a training in August, the full day training that we had on trauma-informed care. And I heard Carrie out of one ear alluding to that, the piece of kids do well if they can. And that was Dr. Green who said that, and he's a well-known author with behaviors and trauma. And that training has really changed beliefs of teachers. And I probably have had a handful of teachers come up to me yet so far this year and said that was really timely. The things that we've learned, I'm seeing in kids. And again, just building that capacity, building those beliefs in how we can help our students and become more engaged. And along with that, the staff engagement. Some of the things, some of the actions that we have taken this summer in July, there was a team from Sauk Trail, 10 of us that attended the Social Justice Institute in the UW campus. And that was an action that really dug at those values and beliefs. It was, we spent a week together and vacillated through being excited to feeling hopeless to being really hopeful and having a lot of great discussions, and really was the impetus to start making some changes and say we can't just sit with our beliefs but keep doing things in the same way. So really looking at our service delivery, looking at how we use resources, looking at how we allocate people, how we allocate money. And really trying to disrupt a well-intentioned system. So feeling good about some changes that we've been making, and hoping we see good results from those. Another action that we did district-wide was the adaptive schools training, which I'm sure you've heard pieces of that. All the administrators and a lot of school leaders were trained, and just another way to do business to increase that engagement, and have been utilizing that philosophy with our PLCs at grade levels, with our professional development, staff meetings, and has really trying to make our time, our collaborative time, really targeted and meaningful. And I don't know if any of you have read Daring Greatly. And she talks about minding the gap, and that gap which is between our practice values, what we're actually doing, thinking and feeling, and our aspirational values, what we want to do, think and feel. And we've, as a staff, have been really trying to navigate that unsettling territory of, like, we know we need to make some changes. How do we jump into that and feel comfortable with that in the best interest of our students? And, you know, we get a lot of type A personalities in education. Just tell me what to do and I'll do it. And a lot of rule followers, but it's really trying to find out, it's not me to tell you, we've got to figure it out together, and that's not going to feel as comfortable as just following a manual or following a directive, but we're getting in there. We're waiting in that territory, and I was sharing it in my small group today, gave it to her today. You know, the teachers are happy and the kids are happy, like, what's going on? And it's feeling like we've got a lot of good things going on. People are working hard, get tired, but they keep moving forward. So it's kind of where we're at. Questions? Or do you
want to have Well, we'll go ahead with questions first, but it's still fresh in mind. I would start again with Todd.
I don't have any specific questions, but thanks for the information on the gap. And I'm not surprised that things are going great after what we heard in our groups today. So thanks for presenting.
I was going to say it was interesting that you talked about the kind of the getting uncomfortable, I think was the phrase that you used, because that came up in our small group too, in terms of, well, Raz was in that group with us, but something
it was very as usually when they see one, they go right to the next school and everything. So that was neat to see that. Hard to follow something like that, but I guess I'm going to focus here a little bit on student and staff engagement. And just for the past 3 years, our focus really at Northside has been really on relationships. And when you think about relationships in schools, you primarily just think about relationships with kids or relationships with families. But really looking at everything we do as a relationship, relationship with each other as a staff, relationship with the school, so we know what's going on, so we're not just thinking about our room, we think about a whole school, a relationship with the district, that you know you're a piece of something greater than just your room or your school, relationship with the state. The state tells us what to do a lot of the time, so what kind of relationship we have with that. But just look also at relationship with yourself, and relationship with your family, your friends, and really focusing on all that together. So when we talk about that student engagement, it's not just about student engagement, it's about when you engage students, you engage staff as well. And it becomes that focus. And our focus is not just our students on our side. But we try to branch out and we try to look, how can we engage students at the middle school, at the high school? How can we bring, I've got a group of high school kids that come and volunteer on Friday afternoon from 4:15 to 5:15 and teach a science exploration class. So to engage those students at the high school, bring them down. Just this past weekend we had our fall festival, and most of our booths were run by former Northside students, high school and middle school students, coming back to do that. Jerry's daughter was there doing that. How do they give back to their elementary school? Chris and I work with the other elementary principals and doing the walk the halls when you graduate. We're engaging kids to know that their education is bigger than just what they are. How do they see the big picture with that? So it's neat to see those kind of opportunities that we give to, we really say all kids. It's not just my Northside kids, it's all kids. It's our third year of working with our student engagement program, our SPLASH program. Our SPLASH is our mission at Northside, that we promise that Northside is going to be a safe, positive learning environment that's always supportive with high expectations for the acronym in education, is SPLASH. It's our third year of doing that, where we take every single student, we break them up into mixed grade groups, and every adult in the building takes a group. I've got a group. My admin assistant has a group. My nurse has a group. Every adult takes a group of 12 to 13 kids. And my teachers write a curriculum during the summer. And our curriculum this year, our theme this year is being different is awesome. So we focus on a bigger theme about the fact that our kids know that I don't want 430 of the same kids. To be different is awesome. To be a Northsider means you need to be different than anyone. How can they be comfortable with themselves to know these things? We've got a speaker coming in tomorrow, Ryan Hack, who wrote a book, Different is Awesome. That's where we got the theme. He lives with one hand. He's going to come and talk to the kids about how being different has made him awesome. It's opportunities like that that we engage kids in real life discussion about things that are not just going to be elementary, but lifelong. How do you understand what your place is and how you can be confident in yourself when you go to middle school during those difficult times or in high school and you know who you are? We want to start building that from the age of five on. Our teachers build relationships with those kids, and the kids build relationships across grade levels. It's a pretty neat experience. We have parents that come in and design things for our kids. Last Friday, we had our second Run Walk Move event where we had over 80 parents volunteer and probably another 60 parents come and watch, and 99% of my kids ran at least a mile that day. And it's not about, it's a fundraiser type thing, but it's not about that. It's about getting kids active and engaging them in how do they do things to keep themselves active in life and take care of themselves. Before that, we'd have Mr. Schmidt, our awesome Phi Ed teacher, would ask the kids to run a mile and their legs would hurt or they wouldn't feel so good. 99% of my kids ran a mile that day. What a great engagement opportunity for those kids. Led by parents, supported by my staff. And I would say 99.9% of my staff ran at least a mile that day with the kids. So you want to talk about engaging kids, it's also engaging staff at the same time because they're the ones that are doing it. Our equity team, like all of our buildings have it, but we're switching it now to where my staff leads it. I don't lead it. I've got a list a mile long. Roz, I want January. I've got a group I want to bring in. Roz, I want February. I just saw this great article and I want to teach the staff about this. Where I no longer do that, they take over to do that. And it comes to what Chris had said, that piece about our adaptive schools and teaching my staff how to be more effective and really get down to and ask difficult questions and how do we work together. It's not the buzzword of you guys go collaborate or do things. It's let me give you the tools. Our school improvement team is refocused this year with the help from Mary Beth and myself working together and modeling how does that look, teaching them the skills during that so they can take it back to their teams to work. And really looking at Northside to say, we do some pretty good things. We do some pretty great things. But what do we need to do besides that? Where do we go from that? And really focus our energies to look at what can we do? They're always coming up with ideas, fantastic ideas, and just some really, 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 really great work that they do. I couldn't be more proud of the work that my staff and my kids do at Northside. Is there any questions for me?
Thank you again, Mr. Parent, for not meeting the staff twice.
Working with you, I should say. So.
John, like that.
I'm going to kind of echo what Todd said, but the passion that you show when you make these presentations and the examples you give, and we're grateful to have that kind of passion here. I, as a former Northside parent, want to also say thank you. You have done a fabulous job of maintaining the level of activity with the students. You know, parents come and go as our students go on to different schools, but without that passion and that commitment to keeping that kind of activity going, that would drop by the wayside. So with the awards you won, was it three that the school won this year? I mean, that is fabulous.
Who's counting, huh?
Thank you, because those are not easy things to coordinate and put together, and without the common denominator of making that, you know, getting that out there and getting parents involved and continuing that effort, it wouldn't happen. So thank you.
Thank you.
I had one question, sir, and I'd like to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
After we ran the mile?
I got seven in that day, so. Nice work out there.
Kept laughing. Nice.
Yeah, I just kept going and going with all the kids. So, yeah, I was able to run with all the kids and get my workout in. So, okay.
Seriously, I just wanted to acknowledge for both of you, it takes, makes for a very long day and a long week to run a school all day and then come to a late board meeting and then get up tomorrow and do it all over again. So thank you for what you do.
Thank you very much. And again, it's appreciated. I know this is, you come here once a year, you sit down and figure out, well, geez, what does the board want to hear? What can I tell them? What are the positive things I can show? What things are they going to throw at me? You know, so it's nice that we're able to pair up with the round table as well as you coming in. Mm-hmm. So I think in this report, we got your report card, but we got it before you guys even started by having your employees come here and talk with us. We got a much better feel for what was going on in your school, more so than what you're able to tell us. And I know from what I heard from listening to different groups, you guys did very well. So appreciate that.
Thank you both. You're outstanding leaders.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Jim, thank you for being patient.
He was telling me he's got to go first.
Well, we should have brought him up here. My apologies for not doing it right away. Jim is up here just because I had noticed, as well as some other board members had noticed, that we've had just a very large uptick in terms of in the past, technology has done just a very fantastic job, but we've just never gotten the type of emails we're getting now that I get at my place of work, and I know that other people get at their place of work. And perhaps if you could just talk a little bit about that so we can talk about perhaps ways of handling that.
So the emails that you've been getting that are malicious, and pretty much anything that comes in with links that try and send you to spam or malware sites we call malicious, are actually coming from our contact form on the webpage. So when someone sends a direct email to board@mcpasdk12.us, it goes through a series of spam filters that actually weed out the stuff that you shouldn't be getting. When it comes from that form, there isn't any way for us to do that because that's already sitting inside of our firewall. And so we don't have a spam filter between that form and the emails that you're getting. The difficulty, of course, is that we just don't get very many emails there. So to put in another filter, which would be several thousand dollars per year to maintain for the 20 to 30 emails that we get per month or so, it would just not be, I mean, it's just not cost effective. So we have a security feature on the form called CAPTCHA. It forces a person to type in what's in a picture. The picture is hard for a computer to read, so it prevents bots from being able to read that CAPTCHA and then put it in. And the reason we know that we haven't been hacked by a bot is because we're only getting one or two or maybe six a day. If somebody actually had technology to beat our CAPTCHA, we'd be getting several thousand a day. And so clearly, whoever is sending this, and it's probably Russian, the one we just got an hour ago is from Russia, is probably got somebody who they're paying like a small amount of money to beat CAPTCHAs and paste in the text of the email. That's not really what concerns me, because I think everybody here recognizes that all the spam that you guys have been getting is, you know, something that you obviously would never click on, right? And so I think the thing that I'm worried about is that when someone figures out how to send one in, realizing that you're a school board, and I don't think they realize you're a school board because they probably wouldn't be wasting the person's time if they knew it was only going to 10 or 12 people. But if somebody were to realize you're a school board and were to maliciously attack you with something that looked genuine, that's kind of what scares me. Because you may not have any idea at all that it's something malicious until you've clicked that link. And so I guess my recommendation to you would be that given how little that form is used legitimately and how now obviously someone is beating it with a human on a regular basis, that we disable that form and quit using it and just have people send direct emails to the board.
This is basically the main reason we're having this here. So can you give the pluses and minuses for that particular recommendation?
Well, on the plus side, we quit getting all this malicious email. On the minus side, lots of people don't have email addresses. And so in order for them to send you an email, they'd actually have to establish an email for themselves. I'm not sure how big of an issue that is. Looking back over the last 2 years, you've rarely received legitimate emails from that form, and they've always been from somebody who had an email address. In fact, the form asks for an email address so that you can do the correspondence back and forth. So I don't think that's a large issue. It does let people anonymously send emails to the board. I'm not sure if that's a pro or con. I know that a couple came from Jesus Lunch, and we know that they didn't really look like legitimate emails to respond to. I'm not sure if anybody tried to respond to them, but I'm guessing that the emails were fake.
At least from what I can tell.
So I guess on the con side, getting rid of the form means that the community will have to use some type of an email tool to send to you rather than using a form that we provide them. On the positive side, we stop getting malicious emails, and it makes sure that we don't have at any point an email that's going to cause either damage to your computer or to your network account.
So at this particular point in time, you know, we have a recommendation, you know, from our technology. Are there any concerns, pro or con, at this time for any board members?
An observation, since I've been a board member, I can honestly say I have not received, that I can remember, one single email directed directly to me as a board member from a citizen. So from that standpoint, I don't think people are banging down the, you know, doors to get at me with email. They have my phone number, they can come to a board meeting, they approach me in the community, and they still have the access to email me through that other way if we took that away. So that's, again, an observation.
This hasn't happened for a while, but we have received in the mail, you know, good old-fashioned stamped mail to our houses from people. And so if you don't have an email account, there's still other avenues for you to use. And
good
I also
point.
You know, the part about sending an anonymous email, that's a slippery slope. And I think if you wanted to make your point, then you should be able to attribute it to yourself. And I think we've gotten in the past on different issues that have come before us, some really threatening nasty messages, that if you would not own that and write your name on it, then you probably need to not send it anyway.
Adamant, I don't know, enthusiastic of those type of emails have come through, semi-anonymous. You know, we usually end up figuring out who it is sooner or later anyway. Any other board members?
Well, I'm a little sensitive to taking away a way for people to contact us, but I think there are other ways that we are available, not only through emails, but aren't our home telephone numbers on the website? Yeah, they're listed on the directory, so it's not like we're running away and hiding, I guess. And I don't know, just speaking from the way I do things, if I have to email someone and I'm on a website and it says contact us and I click on that and a form comes up, I never send the form. I mean, who fills out the form? You just find the email and you email them. So I guess it doesn't concern me too much that we're taking away one way that constituents and people from the district can contact us, and if it's better for, you know, if it reduces a threat to the district's accounts, I guess I'd support it.
Let me just clarify. When I said there was inside our firewall, what I really meant was that it was inside our DMZ. We don't have that web page doesn't sit with like inside of our firewall. It's isolated from the rest of our network because it's public facing, and that's where we see most of the interest for attacks. So it sits in a secured partition of our network, but it doesn't go through the spam filter, which actually is in the Google Cloud and at Gmail. Sorry.
On the subject of anonymous communications, I assume if someone wants to approach the board or the district with something where anonymity is important and legitimate, there are certainly ways we can respect that. We don't have to.
Email account themselves, and we don't
Well, they call George and say, I have something I need to talk to someone about, but I'm a little afraid of coming forward because it's a personal safety issue or whatever it is. I'm sure there are ways.
Gotten anonymous letters via the U.S. mail,
yeah,
too.
So I think it's probably a good idea.
Same thing when Jim and I talked about this a little bit, and I got thinking, like, well, the board never really initiated what you have in there in the first place. It wasn't a board action. It was, you know, technology. You set that up already. So I didn't want to make a change because this has the board on there. So anytime a change is made where the public is addressing the board, I think it's very important that the whole board talk about it before we make a change in that. So unless there's any objections, I think we'll go with Jim's suggestion and go forward, and then maybe sit back, and after a couple months, George and I and the agenda committee can just check in and see if there's any changes need to be made. But I think it's always important that we keep access to communications always out there. But in this particular case, I think it's become more of a negative than a positive. Thank you very much, Jim. Appreciate you waiting. Nice shirt.
We're going to put another order together, by the way, everyone, so you can, since you're modeling. Yeah.
I heard that if you go to Kohl's, you can get stuff like for almost free. So I went to Kohl's, I got a really cheap shirt, yep. And Rainey had this great place and received it around with Sunbury that has the embroidery. So
I have two myself, and they turned out very nice. So
we'll put another order together for everyone.
Okay, facilities planning
yes,
committee.
And again,
update.
Just to remind everyone, the purpose of this is so that you stay fully informed with what the committee is doing. And so every month there will be a facilities planning committee update. And this will be the last one I give because the co-chairs will start giving them after tonight. And I'll just kind of walk you through real quick the highlights. I had another great meeting. This one was held at Cromery because the committee wanted a tour of Cromery and kind of learn about some of our collaboration spaces and other elements. So we started with a grounding activity that Lori led that was excellent. Got asked members to describe their ideal learning environment. And so they started popcorning and brainstorming, you know, what was a great learning environment, you know, look like. And some of them thought about, you know, places they've been in the workplace. Sometimes it was back in college. And so just to kind of get the juices flowing. Sherry went through the entire enrollment update, showed everything that you've seen. So they had a picture of the district, but also she dug deeper into the demographics of each school, and she will actually be bringing that to you in November at an upcoming meeting. But they got a feel for who our students were and where they were located. Then Bill Eberhardt and Lori Ames did an incredible job with the the facilities condition report. We presented it to you last meeting. But we actually walked through that step by step, school by school, so that they could really answer questions or ask questions we can answer and get a feel for what's currently available in our school, ages of the buildings, and so forth. So we feel like they were in a really good place in terms of understanding enrollment, demographics, facilities. And so you have all of that there for you in the handout. Finally, we took a 30-minute tour. They asked a lot of good questions. We, again, focused on collaboration spaces, flexible classrooms, how the nanowalls are used, how we're bringing in natural lighting, because they want aspects of all of that in any future building that we do. Then we came back, and we had an election for co-chairs. We had two volunteers, so we didn't even need to vote. Bob Hesselbein and Luke Francois both volunteered to be co-chairs, and they both have connections to this district. Bob is a former board member. Luke is a former employee. So our next meeting will be at Middleton High School on November 2nd. They asked for that because they want to tour the high school, and that's going to be probably an hour tour just to get through the whole school. And then Lori's going to do a piece on state funding and state formula. You know, they want to know how that all works and why do we need a referendum and so on. So that's a brief update. I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
Well, I did want to notice that Steve Plank was looking at the Cromery Library for the very first time with, no doubt about it, library envy. He was just looking at that going, because his actuality, I think the library there was probably larger than what we have in the high school, and he's just, I think it's the first time he'd seen that and really paid attention to it. So you could just tell, it's like, wow. middle school has a better library than the high school does at this particular time. Very impressive structure, so.
George, are they planning on touring every school, just so they have a better idea of where challenges are coming from?
Yes, so every meeting, they decide where they want the next meeting to be. So, it's fantastic, it's a great group. And this time, you can see all the members and every, you know, the names, you might, there may be people that you recognize, so. It's a great group, so I think they're going to come up with wonderful recommendations down the road.
Questions? I was there just to kind of listen in, and there was a wide variety of people there with a wide variety of questions and interests, so I think this will do well for us as a whole. So again, thank you to everybody for getting that organized. Okay, move on to items for action. Adopt the 2016-2017 budget and certify the tax levy.
All of you should have received the booklet that was in your board packet. And I just want to just identify a couple of things. We did have quite an increase in our enrollment compared to what we projected. We started out with 140. And we actually increased another 94. And when we looked at a three-year average, we actually increased 31 in our three-year average. So that ended up adding about an additional $327,000 to our revenue limit. So what that means is that we had the authority to generate either through taxes or through state aid that additional $327,000. When we look at state aid, we actually received about $965,000 more than what we estimated. When we looked at our July 1st aid estimate, we were within thousands, you know, in what we were estimating. But our aid estimate in July is based on everybody's budget data. It's not reflective of what's actual. We don't get an aid certification until they get all of our actuals in, and it ended up resulting in us receiving any more or even more. Again, that's really more related to the fact that our property values went up so much compared to the rest of the state last year. So we looked more property poor. I shouldn't say our property values. Our student count went up, but our property values did not go up so much that it kind of offset that. Yeah. So our last year, I think our property values only went up 2.8 or something to that effect, but we had such a high student increase. Now this year, it's going to be a little bit different because if you keep going down the road, we had a 5.94% increase in our property valuation. That's pretty amazing. And we should really be excited about the commercial growth and the things that we're seeing in the community. That was 3.9% more than we had originally based our preliminary budget on. So from what we showed in the preliminary of an 11.13% or mill rate, it dropped to a 10.63. So it dropped 50 cents from what we originally talked about, but that's actually a dollar lower than last year. So that's good news all over. In terms of expenditures and revenues, from a percentage standpoint, you didn't really see much of a percentage change. Maybe a percent, like I think it was 71% was our preliminary budget for taxes in terms of all of our revenues. Because of that additional aid, it dropped to 70. Our state aid went from like 21 to 22. So really in general, what we saw in terms of how we're spending our money and how we're receiving our money, the percentages didn't change very much at all. Sure.
You're talking about the mill rate, you know, I hear it went down 0.5, but then you said it dropped.
When you compare it to last year, this right here, this just shows what we talked about in the preliminary budget compared to the actual. But when I compare it to last year, it's actually a dollar lower. So our actual dollar amount that we're taxing is decreasing by over 3%. That's huge for our taxpayers. That's because of the increased state aid we received. Because remember, our revenue limit stays the same. It's just how it's distributed. So when you get more state aid, your taxes are going to go down. So we see a 3.19% decrease in the amount we're taxing. We see a 5.94% increase in our values, and therefore we see that drop in our mill rate of a dollar compared to last year. And because we're seeing an amount decrease in what we're taxing, it's a decrease just in general for what taxpayers should see, although I would preface that with our values. Just because we're seeing a 5.94 district-wide, it's also going to, you know, how that impacts each taxpayer in the townships may be different depending upon what's happening in their area and how things get moved from taxing on an equalized versus taxing on an assessed. So we always just kind of preface that.
So as an example, City of Middleton saw an increase of 10% on their property valuations. Like say Village of Cross Plains only saw 1.5%. So it's more likely than somebody in the Village of Cross Plains may see a decrease in their total tax bill for the school versus say somebody in the City of Middleton, just because there's a higher increase. They're paying a higher percentage of the total pie now in the City of Middleton area.
But even just a 10% growth in the City of Middleton, holy cow, that's huge.
Yeah, I know.
And then the final pages of this document are just the required notifications that we have to put in the paper based on what revenues and what expenditures changed as a result from what was approved in the preliminary budget. And so if approved, then we will turn around and certify the tax levy to the municipalities this week, and then we will fill out the budget report that's due for the state.
So at this particular time, this is an action item. So we're looking for a motion to adopt the 2016-2017 budget for the Middleton-Cross Plains Area School District as proposed and certify a tax levy in the amount of $65,426,013.
I'll second.
Questions, discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, thank you. And thank you very much, Lawrence.
And we'll start the new process in December for next year. Or November, actually, really.
That's great.
The wheel turns around one more time.
Is this the vote that we normally did right around Halloween?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry. I'm not sure. Good.
Okay. Second reading of board policies 1A, 1B.1 through 1B.3.
Yes. Just for an update for the board, we were going to take the suggestion that was brought up for policy 1-B.3 last Monday, but for some reason the Prairie Cafe is not open on a Monday.
We so know we that.
So now the rest of us know that as well. So we were not able to make the changes to 1-B.3. We do have a meeting scheduled on November 2nd. Make those changes at that time. But if everybody is still good with policies 1A through 1B.2, they haven't changed. I don't know if anybody would like us to go through those.
So at this particular time, we're looking for a motion to approve the second reading of policies 1A, 1B1, and then 1B2.
Correct.
Further questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much for that. We're going to, there's no other items on the agenda and for open, so we'll be looking for a motion to convene in a closed session under SS 19.85, subsection 1G, update on a legal situation litigation status. I think this is a roll call vote, if I remember correct.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'll move that we go into closed session.
Second.
Yes.
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 Aye.
Gotta have one.
Where's one?
Okay, take a couple of minutes.